Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Last Chance Café, written by Liz Byrski and read by Marie-Louise Walker. The dedication reads, for Mark and Neil. Chapter 1. The mall is seething with Saturday morning shoppers. Couples joined at the hip, families with screaming toddlers and grumpy adolescents, noisy groups of teenage girls, and elderly people doggedly doing circuits in the centre's motorised carts. Margot hates it. Not just this mall, which is inappropriately named Central Park, but all shopping centres. The harsh lighting, the crowds, the noise, and the air devoid of negative ions suck the life out of her. This morning she is searching, with mounting irritation and a touch of desperation, for something to wear to her sister's golden wedding anniversary. A dress, or perhaps a loose top, matched with a well-cut skirt, which will need to have an elasticised waistband. Either way, it must be designed for comfort and concealment. But although there is adequate evidence that many women her own size and larger shop here, the mall has little to offer. Margot longs to abandon the search, get a coffee, or just go home. But she has to find something, because the party is tomorrow and she can't get into her only decent dress. It is, as she is making her way out of yet another boutique that caters for stick insects, that she notices a small crowd gathering around the escalator that leads exclusively to the beauty salon and day spa on the gallery level. Some of the salon staff, fetchingly dressed in matching shell pink uniforms, are leaning over the balustrade, watching the drama unfolding on the ground floor. Invisible, at the centre of the crowd, someone, a woman, is shouting something unintelligible and heading towards the knot of people are two burly security guards, one talking into a radio handset, the other carrying a pair of bolt cutters. An accident, perhaps? Margot wonders. Someone trapped on the escalator? Somewhere a camera flashes. Edging her way into the crowd, Margot stretches up on tiptoe. A woman, a tiny, elderly woman with bright burgundy hair, has chained herself to the stainless steel railings on either side of the escalator, effectively barricading it. Dot, Margot gasps. Oh my God. Dot it is. Striking as ever, entirely in black except for a large square of cream canvas stitched inexpertly to the front of her sweater. On the canvas is a message written in red felt pen. Wanna be beautiful? Be your age! And Dot is shouting something now about the ugliness of the beauty business, about makeovers and consumerism. Margot can barely believe her eyes. Dot! It's ages since she's seen her, almost 3 years since she took off, ostensibly for a longish holiday, and since then just a few postcards from India. No explanations, nothing. Even Lawrence hadn't had a clue what she was up to. The crowd shifts slightly, making space for the security guards, and Margot pushes through to the front. One of the guards is speaking to Dot now. His tone is low and apparently conciliatory, but Dot is not in the mood for conciliation. Don't you patronise me, she shouts, glaring up at him. I'm not some silly old woman who's lost her marbles. Unfortunately for Dot, this is exactly how she appears both to the guards and the crowd. But then, Margot thinks, they don't know Dot. Come on, love, the man says, loud enough now for others to hear. You can't stay here, you know. People can't get up and down the escalator. Just give me the key to the padlock, or we'll have to use the bolt cutters. Don't you dare cut that chain, Dot cries. Don't even think about it. It's my chain. Then give me the key to the padlock. I've swallowed it, Dot retorts with a gleeful cackle. There is a murmur among the crowd, a mix of amusement and amazement. The security man rolls his eyes and nods to his partner to start cutting. That's damage to my personal property and in front of witnesses, Dot yells. I shall sue. Now look here, love, and don't call me love. He takes a deep breath. Very well then, madam, he says, unravelling the now severed chain and taking her by the arm. Now, I'd like you to come quietly to the centre manager's office. If not... Margot knows that the chances of Dot going anywhere quietly are as remote as a snowball's chance in hell. Next thing, she'll be lying on the ground, forcing them to drag or carry her. Excuse me, she says, elbowing aside a teenager with a video phone and tapping the guard on the arm. This lady's with me. Margot? Dot says, twisting around at the sound of her voice. Good Lord, what are you doing here? Shopping, Margot says, turning a fierce gaze on Dot in the hope of silencing her. We're shopping, remember? And now I'm taking you home. She turns to the security guard with a smile that she hopes is kind but firm. I'll look after her now. So sorry she's caused all this trouble. Don't you apologise for me, Margot, Dot says. I won't have it. The man hesitates. I'm not sure. Oh, she won't do it again, Margot says, with an assurance she doesn't feel. She'll be fine when she's had a nice cup of tea. Well, if you're sure, we don't want to come on too strong, not with, well, an elderly lady who's a bit... He falters and exchanges a nod with the other guard. I might do it again. In fact, I probably will, Dot says. I have plenty more chain. Come along, Dot, Margot insists, smiling at the guards. Thank you so much. She grabs Dot's arm and drags her, protesting, away from the scene of the crime, to the accompaniment of laughter and some mild applause from a few of the rapidly dispersing crowd. Whatever were you doing, Dot? Margot demands, once they are out of sight of the security men. You could have been arrested. I probably would have been if you hadn't have shown up, Dot says, swapping an obviously heavy green shopping bag to her other shoulder. That's what I was aiming for. Margot steers her to the safety of a cafe and nudges her into a booth with upholstered benches. Don't you dare move from there, she says. If you cause any more trouble, they'll cart you off to the manager's office and call the police. You didn't really swallow the key, did you? Of course not, Dot grins, reaching down inside the neck of her sweater. It's here on this very nice lanyard sent to me by Amnesty International. If you're getting the coffee, I'll have a long black, please. I've done it before many times, Dot says, when Margot returns with the coffee. But then you know that. Margot does indeed know that. She has seen her do it on at least four occasions, from one of which she was dragged off shouting and thrown into the back of a police wagon. I remember, she says, particularly the first time I saw you do it, the Save Our Sons campaign. A lot of very respectable-looking women in hats and gloves marching with banners and the lunatic fringe chained up outside Parliament House. I remember that, Dot says. We were all there. You had Lexi with you, and Emma in a pusher, and Lawrence was there too. Margot nods. That's right. Emma was still quite small. How is Lawrence? Dot asks. It's ages since I saw you, and even longer since I saw him. He's okay, Margot says. He's away doing that horrendous walk to Santiago de Compostela. It's madness, of course. I don't think he'll last the distance. You know Lawrence. Exercise is not his thing, but he's been a bit out of sorts lately. He was 74 last month. Everyone's younger than me, Dot says, grimacing. Just turned 75. She sips the hot coffee cautiously. No, it doesn't sound at all like Lawrence. I'd love to catch up with him when he gets back. Oh, but it's great to see you, Margot, and amazing, because you hate shopping centres. Desperation, really, Margot says, and explains about the party. She's pretty fearsome as I remember her. Not my kind of woman, Philippa. Phillida. Of course, Phillida. Unusual name, I always mix it up. I think I once called her Phillida, after that talking horse in the fairy tale. Oh, yes, the goose girl. Unkind of me, but she was a bit of a bossy mare, wasn't she? And they both dissolve into laughter. Oh, Dot, it's so good to see you, Margot says. I got so used to having you around, I really missed you, and you're a hopeless correspondent. So, tell me about India. What were you doing? What made you stay so long? Dot rolls her eyes. I know. Went off on holiday and didn't come back. Didn't let anyone know. Totally unreliable and don't deserve to have any friends. Like I said when I left, Margot, I planned to go for several weeks, maybe even 2 or 3 months. But India... She pauses. Well, it hung on to me, I suppose. It's such a culture shock. You laugh, but I got that finding myself bug and ended up at a retreat centre in a decaying old palace in the mountains. Amazing place. Glorious scenery. Lovely people. I did it all. Meditation, fasting, being silent, writing down every thought, every memory. Try as she might, Margot couldn't imagine Dot meditating on an Indian mountain, or anywhere else for that matter. She can't see her in a white robe, omming peacefully, eating chickpeas and dal, and especially not being silent. It sounds too still, too regimented, too passive. Was she allowed to smoke? Did she attempt to reorganise the place? Did she have to let her burgundy hair grow out? Were there any protests to organise? It is so entirely un-Dot. Sounds a bit confronting, she says. So, did you find yourself? Unfortunately, I did. You know, Margot, I was absolutely sick of myself when I went there. Sick of being that Dot Granger person, you know, curmudgeonly columnist, broadcaster, chain smoker, activist, rat bag. I needed to see who I was underneath all that. And what did you find? Well, sadly, I discovered that was it. That is who I am. I'd hoped that it was some sort of shell, and I might discover a finer, more measured person lurking within, but it seems that's who I am, right down to my bone marrow. Such a disappointment. I think it's a relief, Margot says. I never imagined for a moment that all that passion and commitment came from anywhere but the heart and soul. You're very kind, but I'm so over myself you wouldn't believe it. And I couldn't even get away from me at the top of some Indian mountain. I stayed a full year, so you can't say I didn't try. And then I thought, well, maybe I need to be doing something rather than, you know, just being there contemplating my navel. After all, I am a doing sort of person. So I went to Mumbai and worked with an aid organisation that helps slum dwellers. Oh, the awfulness of it, Margot. The children, the poverty. Anyway, I just got stuck in, cooking, washing, dressing wounds, things I never dreamed I'd do. And? Well, that sort of thing does change you, but I still didn't find the finer person. I was still a ratbag, even in India. But at least I was a useful one. I got back about 3 weeks ago, and I've been finding it hard to settle. And even I haven't had the cheek yet to start calling people to say, I'm back, take notice of me. Well, you should have. I missed you, and a couple of postcards didn't stop me worrying about you. Margot says, and this morning? What was that all about? Protesting again, of course, although I made a very bad job of it. That's the thing, you see. I would never have gone at it like that in the past. I'd have planned it with other people, had a strategy. Collective action was always my thing. Good thing you turned up when you did. But what's it about? Margot persists. Even I couldn't understand what you were on about. Dot looks uncharacteristically sheepish. I know. That's a sign of my own disorientation, I think, because it's about everything, really, and that's the problem. Coming back here, it's a culture shock. The consumerism and everything seems to be about appearance. I can't really explain it. Well, you won't change anything doing what you did this morning, Margot says. Work out what your issue is and plan your strategy carefully. That used to be your mantra. Dot rolls her eyes. Well, I was right. Pity I didn't take my own advice this time, and chains are a bit dated, I suppose. I need to find another way or I'll start to sound like a nutter. Margot nods. A nutter is exactly how you looked and sounded this morning. Activists these days do it with blogs. Dot sighs. I suppose so. But you know, Margot, doing stuff alone is hard and no one seems to care about sisterhood anymore. She leans forward, grasping Margot's hand in her own. Remember the women's movement, working together? Remember marching for childcare centres and equal pay and breast cancer testing? It's not the same now. It's all about the individual and bugger everyone else. Pole dancing as liberation. What a travesty. Remember how thrilling it was back then. Margot does remember. She remembers marching.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.